All right, everybody. It's about 3 minutes after, and I think we can go ahead and at least get started with all of this. How y'all doing? My name is Stuart Brower. I am the Schusterman Library Director, and I am very, very happy to welcome you all to Lightning Round Session 2 for OU-Tulsa Research Week 2021. I will be your MC. I am ably assisted by Alyssa Magdalski, who is going to be taking care of advancing all of our PowerPoint slides for us and generally telling me if I'm doing things right or wrong. I know you wouldn't think that that would be a job, but there you go. I've got a few little announcements before we get started. First of all, a reminder that the Lightning Round sessions are actually presented to you by the Scholar Squad. Scholar Squad is a group that meets at the Schusterman Library, through the Schusterman Library, to talk about all matters related to the life of a researcher. And it's open to faculty, staff, and students. Very welcoming, very worthwhile group. And if you're interested in these things, I'd recommend looking for the topics that they announce every year, what they've got coming up. I'm not really sure. I think we're about wrapping up for the year, but Scholar Squad's a fantastic group. This is, in fact, the fourth year of the Lightning Round sessions. There were two sessions this year. This is the second and final of those. Each presenter gets 5 minutes of presentation time and 5 PowerPoint slides. I'm going to be running the timer, and I have a little note that it'll look backwards in the camera, I know, but it actually says 1 minute left. And at the 1 minute mark, I will be holding this up as your 1 minute warning that you've got that much time left. At 5 minutes, I will unmute myself. And since I don't have a little bell or anything, I thought I'd do the polite thing and just clear my throat. So when you run over time, you'll hear me go, and that means that we've run out of time. Exactly, just like that. So, we're off to a good start. All right. Also, Alyssa will be managing all the PowerPoint slides. So presenters, when you are ready to advance to the next slide, just say next slide, please, and Alyssa will advance you. I think that is all of the things that we need to talk about before we get started. Listed here are all of the presenters, and I'll be announcing each one of them before they begin their presentation. But first up is Claudette Grinnell-Davis, and her presentation is on Profiles of Estimated Indian Child Welfare Act Adherence in National Data, Implications for Data Collection, and Agency Practice Reform. And we'll go ahead and get her title slide up there. And then Claudette, whenever you are ready to begin, just start speaking and I will start the timer.
Thank you, Stuart. Good afternoon. My name is Claudette Grinnell-Davis. I'm faculty here at OU-Tulsa in the School of Social Work. And as a part of this title slide, I want to acknowledge the role of the Office of Research Services at the University in Norman in funding a junior faculty fellowship that originally supported this research. So next. Next, there we go. So most of my research revolves around Indian child welfare. And for those of you who are not familiar with that history, we consider the boarding school era of American Indian displacement to be the beginnings of Indian child welfare in the United States. And generally the date of that is marked to 1879 with the institution of the Carlisle Training School. And what we know is that the boarding school experiment that is marked by the words kill the Indian, save the man, was a colossal failure in any regard, either in the preservation of Indian communities or in the attempt to quote unquote civilize Indian people, obviously in quotes for good reason. So that by the time the Indian Child Welfare Act was passed in 1978, approximately 40% of all Indian children were placed in custody in non-native homes, separated from their family, separated from their kin, separated from their culture, their language, their ceremonies, their lands, and many of which were languishing with significant mental health concerns and intergenerational trauma that we now collectively refer to as historical trauma. Next. So while we do have the Indian Child Welfare Act, one of the problems with it is that we have absolutely no data that is collected at the national level on whether states are following through with the spirit of the Indian Child Welfare Act, which is to keep Indian children in their homes with their families, with their kin, in placements that keep them in contact with their loved ones and their culture and their people. So not only do we not know anything about ICWA compliance, but it is also unknown if the children that are identified as American Indian or Alaskan Native in national foster care data are protectable, because that is a race identifier and not a citizenship identifier. And this is important for the practice of the Indian Child Welfare Act, because eligibility for protection is only to children of tribal citizens who are themselves eligible for citizenship. Further, when collapsed into the forced demographic categories for federal government compliance and demographics, approximately 45% of all American Indian children are erased into the two or more races category when forced into that kind of one label category. By contrast, African-American children are collapsed into the two or more races category at approximately 12 to 15%. What we do know is that based on some analyses I'm doing with a colleague at the University of Georgia, there is available evidence that we can actually isolate or identify potential patterns of ICWA compliance by treating ICWA compliance using known practices of foster care in the data as a latent construct, which is what this presentation is about. Next. So what theoretically, there should be a percentage of the kids in the national data that are placed with kin, have reunification as a goal, have shorter, more stable stays, are mostly children in states with state statutes, are mostly children in states with federally recognized tribes, and are more likely to be children identified as American Indian alone, just based on percentages and probabilities. Next. So as you can see here, there actually is one, what I call a probable ICWA placement profile, that is the second one down with N equals 10,406. However, there are some alarming trends here that indicate still a large number of American Indian children that are farmed out for adoption, from the looks like to non-kin and to non-American Indian carers. But there's also fair evidence that there are some particularly older American Indian children that are more likely to end up in congregate care.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. Next up, we have Deirdra Kelly presenting for Deirdra and Elizabeth Sue on effects of maternal stress on breast milk immune components.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Deirdra Kelly, and I will be presenting on the effects of maternal stress and breast milk immune components, a meta-analysis. Next slide, please. There are approximately 385,000 babies born each day. Now, that is a lot of breast milk. It is therefore vital for us to understand not only what is in breast milk, but also what external factors may alter its composition. Breast milk is commonly thought of as the ideal food for babies. Indeed, it is composed of essential macro and micronutrients, non-pathogenic bacteria, oligosaccharides, hormones, and immune components. These help a baby develop its microbiome, immune system, and they even play a role in the development of organ systems, such as a baby's neural development. In our meta-analysis, we looked at immune components specifically, including macrophages, neutrophils, cytokines, and many immunoglobulins such as IgG and IgA. I would now like to turn your attention to the upper left-hand side of your screen. Here you will see maternal psychopathology, which includes depression, anxiety, and stress. Our meta-analysis asks the question, how does maternal stress influence breast milk immune components? Our meta-analysis is still ongoing, and to our knowledge, this will be the first meta-analysis on the role of stress in milk immune components. What we find could have far-reaching implications for breastfeeding mothers, babies across the world, as well as for formula companies, which are always trying to improve formula to better replicate that of maternal milk. Next slide, please. What do these animals have in common? You're right, they all produce breast milk. In the beginning of our meta-analysis, we were surprised to find that the majority of research on stress and its impact on milk immune components was studied in cows, pigs, sheep, and goats. Comparatively few studies have been done on human milk. Why is there so much interest in non-human mammalian milk? Economic interests certainly play a role. Not only do farmers want to make sure animal mothers remain healthy to increase production of milk, they also want to make sure the composition of milk supports a healthy development of their young, and that the milk itself, particularly cow's milk, has a quality that is acceptable to us, the consumers. Next slide, please. Because stress was at the core of our study, it was important that we reach a consensus on what stress meant and what type of stress we would be looking at specifically. This chart demonstrates some of the variables we initially included in our search for stress. There were three broad categories: physical, psychological, and environmental stress. We ultimately found that many of the physical stressors, such as chronic illness and smoking, had to be excluded from our definition of stress. These factors impact the immune system in and of themselves, and we are not able to isolate the stress that was caused by these conditions as an independent factor on immune components in breast milk. Next slide, please. In the end, to be able to define stress, we had to read more than 1,500 abstracts and 100 full text articles. Our definition of stress in humans centered around economic, social, and postpartum stress, including postpartum anxiety and depression. Animal stress centered around their environment. Increased temperature and increased humidity has physiological effects on animals, how much room they have to move around on, the type of flooring provided for them to stand on, such as rubber or hard cement, the amount of shade, and even the quality of indoor ventilation are all stressors for animals. Measuring or quantifying this stress is important, especially in a meta-analysis which synthesizes data. For animals, markers of stress include cortisol, as well as the amount of food eaten, breathing rate, rectal temperature, and behavioral measurements. Human stress was also measured through cortisol levels, as well as by around 20 different self-reported surveys and scales. While it is too early in our meta-analysis to report our results on how stress impacts breast milk immune components specifically, it is not too early to say that stress in animals and humans results in physiological changes that may be passed down from mother to baby. So the next time you pour yourself a nice, refreshing glass of cow's milk, I urge you to pause and think about everything that went into that glass. Research is ongoing about how we can optimize the health of mothers to improve the quality of her milk for the health of both mother and young. That concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you. And now, well, I guess we reverse the two of you. And it is now two novel supplemental methods for conducting meta-analyses by Elizabeth Sue and Deirdra Kelly, presented by Elizabeth Sue.
Thank you. And again, my name is Elizabeth Sue, and today I will be discussing two novel supplemental methods for conducting meta-analyses. Next slide, please. So first, I just want to start by talking about meta-analyses in general and how they work. A meta-analysis is a study that groups together the results of several different but similar studies that relate to your topic of interest. Here you can see a diagram of an evidence pyramid, which I'm sure you've seen before, and this is a way to visualize the hierarchy of evidence. At the top is filtered information, and at the bottom is unfiltered information. The top of the pyramid represents the strongest evidence, and meta-analyses are often considered gold standard. Next slide, please. This slide provides a simplified overview of how to conduct a meta-analysis. You begin by searching for studies that relate to your overarching topic, filter in those studies that address your research issue, and use statistical analysis to determine what the available evidence ultimately concludes about your question. However, there are many other important components and considerations that need to be made when conducting a meta-analysis. And this is because while meta-analyses are considered gold standard, they're only as good as the studies and the data that you put into them. And so this makes steps 2 and 3 crucial for conducting good meta-analyses. For this reason, I will be discussing 2 novel methods used during steps 2 and 3 in our meta-analysis, which looked at how stress influences immune components in breast milk, which was discussed earlier by my colleague, Deirdra Kelly. Next slide, please. In our initial search, we utilized traditional search methods with the help of our librarians here at Schusterman Library. But one important method for our project has been using the program RAN, and this has maximized efficiency during literature selection. RAN is an amazing user-friendly platform that has allowed us to quickly and easily include and exclude our current search results. Upon uploading the papers, duplicates are automatically deleted. In addition, RAN can be blinded, which allowed Deirdra and I to individually decide whether we wanted to include or exclude a paper without seeing each other's progress and choices. The image here has the blind off, which can be done after inclusion and exclusion is completed. When we decided to include or exclude a paper, RAN has pre-made labels with common reasons for inclusion and exclusion, but you can also create your own custom labels. Another advantage of RAN is the ability to upload full PDFs for future review, and this puts all of the information needed to make a decision regarding an article or a study in one location that is well-organized and easy to use. For us, RAN replaced Excel, which is more typically used during literature search and selection. Excel doesn't allow for blinding, automatic deletion of duplicates, or full PDF upload. It is therefore clear to see how RAN allows for a more streamlined and user-friendly process. Next slide, please. Additional methods for our project included manual searching in order to maximize articles selected for inclusion. After Tier 1 inclusion, we reviewed the citations of all included articles and relevant review articles. Additionally, we searched for related similar articles listed on PubMed. And this last step means that we searched for our included articles on PubMed and included relevant suggested articles for review and selection. Each approach was done by one member of our team, and articles were then added to RAN separately for independent inclusion and exclusion. As you can see from these images, these methods resulted in 558 new articles to be screened for inclusion. Ultimately, this added 84 included articles in addition to our initial 35 to be assessed in Tier 2 selection. Through the use of these additional methods, we increased the number of articles eligible for final inclusion from just 35 to 119. The manual search has shown to be beneficial in maximizing the number of articles for selection in our analysis and has allowed us to better pool together data that will more accurately represent overarching trends that exist within this field of research. While other meta-analyses have been found to look through included article citations, to our knowledge, these 3 methods have never been used together in a meta-analysis. So as you could see from the slide outlining the necessary steps to include a meta-analysis, this process takes time and a variety of resources. We have found that incorporating manual searching and RAN has greatly improved both the quantity of studies that we have available for selection and the efficiency and transparency of our literature selection. We therefore believe these methods make valuable additions for conducting meta-analyses. And this concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next presenter, let me pull this up, make sure I forgot, is presenting happenings at the OU Innovation Hub, and it's Diane Varnes. And Diana, whenever you're ready.
All right, I'm ready. So hi everybody, I am Diana Varnes. I have an office over at Schusterman Library, and I am the one person from the OU Innovation Hub that is located at the OU-Tulsa campus. And this is basically just some stuff that we have available that you all may not be aware of, and we are here to serve you. Next slide, please. So the programming that I run in particular are our intent programs, innovation, technology, and entrepreneurship. These are 201 talks where we bring in some big name speakers or big name entrepreneurs to share their stories with you that they started at the ground level and worked their way up to how successful they are, just like anybody else. We have a create challenge that we're doing right now where we challenge people to create something and win a cool prize, as Tom would say. This semester, it's a Designer Retro travel poster. And it's in collaboration with Travel Oklahoma. And overnight prizes are, or prizes are an overnight stay in Tulsa at the Mayo, an overnight stay at 21C Hotel Museum in Oklahoma City, Campus Corner in Norman, or the state park of your choice. We also have our OK Wise conference. This one's a little bit harder to explain. To highlight the scientific, economic, and societal impacts made by women in Oklahoma, this is a STEM conference for women. Hopefully we'll have it again next year, but COVID has thrown kind of a wrench into our plans on it. Founders and Failures, we'll bring in entrepreneurs who talk about their failures along the way and how failure is important to everything they do and important to success. Code the World is a community collaboration that I do with Holberton Schools, or the Holberton, Holberton Coding School, and also Type Rose here in Tulsa, to try to encourage more people to consider technology and computer coding as a career path. And especially now that we have the computer science program here at OU-Tulsa, this is also hopefully a way to bring some attention to what we have to offer here. Our How Do I is a series of workshops, very high level generally, any skill sets that you might have missed in college that would apply to being an entrepreneur. In our virtual coffee sessions, as of today, I have made them bi-weekly instead of weekly, just to come in and talk about what we have to offer at the iHub, questions you may have, just to say hi and meet some cool people if that's what you want. Next slide, please. Our Oklahoma Catalyst programs are fascinating. This is where researchers like yourself, if you're interested in commercializing or monetizing your research, we can help you find contracts through the federal government, through the Small Business Innovation and Research, and I forget what the S is on SCTR, but Technology Transfer Program. And we are gonna have a Catalyst researchers event this summer. I don't have all the details on it yet, but I should have that in the next few weeks. So think about us if you are interested in monetizing your research. Next slide, please. If you have any prototyping that you might need to do for any of your research, then we have a prototyping center and a prototyping manager down in Norman that you can utilize. And next slide, please. And this semester we launched our OU Startup programs. So anyone who decides that they want to try to start their own business, thank you, Stuart. and now I lost my train of thought. Oh, anyone who wants to start their own business, we have our accelerator to help get you started, and we will handhold you through the process of launching your business. And then for established businesses who are in the early stages and want to grow, we've got our incubator that can help you through that process as well. And these programs are, the startup programs are open to anyone who is affiliated with OU, so alum, faculty, staff, students. Everything else that the iHub has to offer is open to anybody and everybody throughout the state of Oklahoma and beyond. And thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Our next presenter is Elise Knowlton, presenting on Oklahoma population census and COVID-19 deaths. Elise, whenever you're ready.
Hi, OU Tulsa. My name's Elise, and I'm a research assistant within the Department of Pediatrics, interested in closely looking at the effects of COVID-19 in Oklahoma. I'll present three primary findings, both descriptive and one part theoretical. COVID-19 needs no introduction. Many of Oklahoma citizens have died from this disease. Next slide, please. My hypothesis, inspired by the social determinants of health framework and health inequities here in Oklahoma, is that individuals of Oklahoma's racial and ethnic minorities are experiencing a disproportionate burden of deaths from COVID-19 at younger ages compared to the racial and ethnic majority. Next slide, please. To explore this hypothesis, I first looked at Oklahoma's population census from 2019 using the U.S. Census Bureau's American Community Survey data. Even though there are limitations with census data, I wanted to see the breakdown of Oklahoma's demographic landscape by age. Dramatically, the proportion of individuals who are white increases as age increases. In the upper left, I'm showing the two age groups on the ends of the census age category spectrum. In the 0 to 4 years age group, individuals who are white, depicted in blue, represent 66% of the Oklahoma population, excuse me. While in the oldest age category, individuals who are white represent 89% of Oklahoma's population. This surprised me. I didn't think it would be this dramatic of a difference. Next, I went to the Oklahoma State Department of Health reports on individuals who have died from COVID-19. And in the upper right, I'm showing the number of individuals who have died from COVID-19 by the age category they're in, spanning 0 to 85+ years of age. These numbers include all individuals, not parsed by racial group. The Oklahoma State Department of Health reports this separately for age and race. But getting back to my hypothesis, I wanted to assess COVID-19 deaths by both age and race simultaneously. And this is not possible to do with the State Department's reports. In an exercise of estimation though, I parsed the number of deaths from COVID-19 in Oklahoma using the Oklahoma population census data as a filter to produce proportions of deaths for racial groups. Basically, I applied the pie chart for each age category to produce a demographic estimate of deaths for racial groups. This is what I'm depicting here in the bottom left of the slide for every age category. The bold total tally for the number of deaths is 4,100 for individuals who are white. And this is based upon how as age changes, so does the proportion of individuals who are white in Oklahoma. Next slide, please. I also did this estimation for Oklahoma's minority racial groups. And in the center right-hand side of the slide, the total turned out to be 750 deaths for Oklahoma's racial minorities together. When compared directly to the actual number of deaths reported by the Oklahoma State Department of Health as of March 31st, across racial groups only, not by age, the number of individuals who have died from COVID-19 and who are white is lower than the estimate. And the number of individuals who have died from COVID-19 and who are in the racial minority groups is higher than the estimate. Next slide, please. Lastly, I wanted to share that the CDC does report the number of individuals who have died from COVID-19 by state, and these estimates are higher than the Oklahoma State Department of Health, but also the CDC reports their numbers by age and race simultaneously. And as of March 31st, the peak number of deaths for individuals who are white was in the oldest age category of 85+ years, while for minority races like American Indian or Alaska Natives, Black or African Americans, and individuals who are multiracial, they are experiencing peak numbers of deaths at younger age categories, a whole two age categories in the younger direction, which could mean up to 20+ years age difference. This is sobering for our state, but the efforts here in our College of Community Medicine that address health disparities give me hope. And with that, thanks for listening.
Thank you very much. Our last presenter is Dr. Yuan Yang, who is going to be presenting on neural engineering for stroke rehabilitation, a collaborative OU research program. And I will point out, Dr. Yang, you had many collaborators, and I felt like I was probably not going to be able to name them all. So I'm just saying et al, and then you may begin your presentation when you're ready.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Good afternoon, everyone. So my name is Yuan Yang. I'm an assistant professor in biomedical engineering at OU-Tulsa. So as we show here, so actually this is a collaborative research across multiple department and across campus with both OU and OUHPC has got involved there. So I'm presenting here on behalf of our group. You will see all the names in the team in the last slide actually. So please move forward for the next slide. Thank you. Okay. So according to Oklahoma State Department of Health, so stroke rate actually in Oklahoma is higher than the national rate, and stroke is the fifth highest cause of the death in our state. It's also the top four cause of the death in Tulsa County. By reviewing the mission of Oklahoma State Health Department as well as the County Health Department, stroke rehabilitation as well as stroke treatment as well as cardiovascular disease treatment are top priority of our county as well as the state. So in Oklahoma, there are around 32 stroke hospitalization per day. So this is a quite large number. And we actually spend half $1 billion in hospital charges for stroke annually in Oklahoma. And the rate for women and underrepresented minority actually is higher than other group in general. And it also has a high death rate in Oklahoma. So one out of 20 stroke patients die. For survivors, stroke is a leading cause of severe and long-term disability in our country, in our state, as well as our county. 80% of our stroke patients report residual movement impairments that greatly impair their independent life. Next slide, thanks. Therefore, the research in the stroke rehabilitation as well as stroke diagnosis treatment is very, very important. So my lab at OU Treatment Center, third floor. So if you want to visit my lab, please feel free to email me and let me know. I can show the lab. So we are focused on the stroke rehabilitation as well as the neuroscience of movement control. So in our lab, we equipped it with 128 channel EEG system, full cap EEG system, allowed us to do the brain activity assessment during the movement, during the sensory assessment. In our lab, we also equipped it with a 16 channel EMG system, allowed us to assess electrical muscle activity. A full set of biodex rehabilitation system allowed us to do the movement exercise in our patient, and TMS system allows us to assess the brain function by delivering the non-invasive brain stimulation signal to the brain. And we also developing the high definition non-invasive brain stimulation as a treatment for our patient. I will show that in our next slide. We have full access to the please go back. We have a full access to the MR facility in Norita Institute, which is in San Frank Hospital, 8 minutes drive from our campus. And we has been, so I'm a OU Norman faculty actually, so I'm engineering faculty. So we have a partnership with OUHSC, School of Community Medicine, OU Physician, as well as a local hospital in Tulsa area, including three major hospitals here, St. John, Hillcrest, and St. Frank's Hospital. We have ongoing research funding from NIH, and currently that my lab lead and clinical trial application that under review with NIH. Next slide. So here is the non-invasive brain stimulation, which we are developed in our lab, will allow us to do a more focused stimulation to our brain as well as underlying neural fiber tracks, and that can do the simultaneous EEG monitoring and the stimulation. In the last slide, let's go to the last slide. Here is our full team. I see that also a couple of our colleagues are actually in attendees today. But as you know, they are also not here because this is a study cross campus and cross department. I would like to thank everyone here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Yang, and my thanks to all of our presenters today. I thought this was wonderful. I love learning about all the amazing things that we're doing here at OU-Tulsa and the way we reach out into the community and the things that we do. So it has been great fun for me to be a part of all this. Thank you to all of the presenters. I also want to extend thanks to my partner in crime, Alyssa Migdowski, for helping us with all of the slides. And a special thanks to our friends over in ORDSA, who do such a great job of putting together the research forum every year. Heather, Krista, Sarah Beth, and Danielle have been tremendous support and help in getting the lightning rounds up, but certainly do a fantastic job with the research forum overall. Tomorrow, research forum awards and winning presentations, that's tomorrow at noon. And I believe that wraps up our research week. So great job, everybody. Thank you all for being a part of this. And I look forward to seeing more of these next year. Have a great afternoon, everyone.